Laura Michelle Kelly. Well, first, how's quarantine been for you, actually?
Actually, to be honest, and I know it's not been like this for everybody, so I say this very sensitively, it's not been much different from just being out of work actor. Mm-hmm. And for me, especially as I just gave birth, I gave birth the first time, October, right as we were stepping into this quarantine situation. I'm pretty sure it hit Seattle long before they say it did, because I remember being very sick at the beginning of last year. 2019. Wait. Yeah. And then it hit us. Wait, 2020. It hit us 2020. Yeah. So I had just given birth and we were stepping into this new year, and both my husband and I were very sick in Seattle in January. And we were quarantining in this new place that we just moved into with friends, because we were just about to move back to Seattle. I have a little place in Louisiana, and we didn't have a place in Seattle, but that's where my husband works. So we were living in two places. So we just moved back. We were living above someone's garage in their apartment, our very dear friends. And then quarantine happened. None of us were like so confused about what to do. We stayed in their apartment for 3 months because everyone was on lockdown. Yeah. So we were in a fantastic bubble with our dear, dear friends. And as each of us kind of thought, maybe do we have it? Do we not? Where do we get testing? Like, we all had to quarantine in this apartment, this big built, they had their mansion part, and we were in the apartment above the garage. It was all a very crazy new mom kind of, didn't even want to venture outside kind of thing, like, what's going on? So we had a great bubble. We were a big group of us having dinner all the time together, except when we were self-isolating in this big apartment building. But really, it's been no different from, you know, if I'd been out of work in LA. I remember feeling very much the same isolation when I was out of work in Los Angeles. So I was used to that. My husband, not so much. So you have to like hold people's hands through it, obviously, because it's very scary. And especially now, you wonder if nothing's ever going to be the same again. But on an upside, it does force you to be very creative in a completely different way. Like, it's forced me to remove what I thought could succeed before, and it's actually blown the glass ceiling off as to what you can do creatively. People are more open to watching stuff on YouTube and creating theatre. Back when it used to be on television, before we entered the business, people would watch theatre on television and it would be exciting. And I think it's gone back to that because there's no other outlet at the moment. And I think that's opening up to a whole new audience, I hope. My brain's filled with ideas, but I kind of has, what's happened is being a new mum and COVID, is I've taken a big step back and not been a part of social media for some time, for like a year. Like, if I'm part of promoting something, I'll get on and do it. I think some people went the other way where they were all out there and putting their stuff on camera and increasing their audience, and I just didn't do that. I just took a step back and I got pregnant again and have another baby, so I made two babies during quarantine.
Well, congratulations. That's a feat in and of itself, so
yeah,
that and
yeah. I would not have believed it 2 years ago that you'd be having you're going to be at home with two young little ones. My first is now 15 months, so that's as long as we've been in COVID, and poor kid has never seen a lot of people without their mask on. Yeah. He lights up when we get outside and we go to a shop, like a grocery store. He'll look at every single person and he'll point and he'll wave. And even though he hasn't seen people without their masks on, his face is like, you know, and he's trying to get a reaction out of them. And most people will like wave and smile. So I hope he's not too, affected by it.
Yeah, I've thought about that every now and then. I'm like, wow, some of these kids that I babysat, they were little itty bitty, and now they're old enough to like realize like kind of what's going on. And I'm like, wow, you're gonna be growing up in like a really weird.
Yeah, you know,
Before we got on, we were chatting a little bit about you know, the social the media differences. And what auditions are like for actors currently. What do you have any like thoughts on, you know, having to all of the self-tapes and things that, you know, all these actors are going through? And
I don't know. I think, I, you know, it's a very different time for me as it was for when all of you not now coming in. Like, I was wondering, like, would it be better off where there's access now for everyone to submit something to someone in a completely different way? You don't have to be in the room anymore. Would that be better? Or I know then when it was back when I started out at 16 or 17 and I was given a pager and I was told to call my agent and you had 2 weeks to plan for an audition and they mailed it to you or you went in to pick it up from the office or and you had 2 weeks before any recall and audition. And I think, I don't know whether that's better or worse. I do love that YouTube. Anybody can get on YouTube and if you find someone, anybody can be watched. You can create your audience, and I think that's awesome. That's like leveled the playing field. It means anybody has an opportunity, including myself, who's not very technologically advanced. I could go out there, but I mean, I haven't. But I think it's nice to know that there's no competition in the fact that you can just put it out there, you know. Mm-hmm. And I wonder if that's better. It, back in the day, it's like if you didn't have an open, they were fighting for open calls. Equity were fighting for open calls so that it was anybody could go in an audition. Mm-hmm. But now you don't even have to show up to the room. You can just submit. So I don't know. I think there's probably pros and cons to both and how to make your video more watchable. And I am not the authority on that. I've notoriously, everybody knows, I'm notoriously bad in auditions. I've never been good at them. When I got to Broadway and had to almost start over, I mean, you say start over, I was lucky enough to be able to play Mary Poppins on Broadway, and then I had to audition for things and learn. There's a whole different level of auditioning process in for Broadway than there was for me at the time in the West End. I'm sure it's changed now, but and I never learned those skills of how to audition well. I think you have to be really good at being given a script and memorizing it within 24 hours. And then within that, you also have to be really good at managing your stress levels and then really good at not being afraid of a whole back panel of people, although they're not supposed to technically be judging you, they're judging you. And I'm not good at that. I want to be in front of an audience who you already know want to show up to have a good time. Right. I already know the piece inside out. I've worked on it. I've made all my decisions. Like, so I'm not, if you say, Laura, here's the job, it's yours, I could be in front of a panel that day and be like, okay, kicking it.
Got it, here
there's
we go.
That element of not having the job yet and being everyone judging you that I have never been good at. But I'm kind of saying that now so that anyone who's in an audition class and still doesn't think they're very good at it, don't worry, because me neither. And somehow, you know, if you're the right person for the job, they're still going to believe in you. It all takes a level of faith. They put their faith in you, mm-hmm. and they see something in you. And so it does, you don't necessarily have to be amazing at that.
Yeah.
I mean, I say that, but I want to encourage someone out there who doesn't feel that they can do it because they're not good at auditioning. Like, go for it anyway. For me, I just chose, look, you've won if you show up. Even if you're bad, there's that tiny element that they'll trust you and put their trust in you. And I've already won if I show up because there's so many, my agent, bless him, so patient with me. I'm like, I can't go, I can't do it. I'm not even kidding.
It's a win for getting the audition in the first place, and then it's a win to get the callback, and
now it's a win to actually be in front of the camera and do it at home and send it, edit it and send it in time.
Yes.
And for me, just you know, I that would be easier, but still I can still avoid.
It's the
time.
It's the times, and then the time difference is always, I'm always like, I don't know where, because I grew up on the East Coast, so half of my brain is on Eastern Standard Time, the other half of my brain is on Central Time, and I'm so sometimes I'm like, I don't know. And now I'm, you know, working, or I have friends that are in the UK, so I'm like trying to figure out their time, and then I have people in California time and people who are like up in Canada.
Wait, you're auditioning all over the world?
I'm not just... auditioning. Oh. I'm just like, I have friends or I'm interviewing people that are all over the place. And I'm like, oh, we said 12 my time, which is 5 your time. I can't get those mixed up. And oh,
but there was a time when I had 3 phones. I had one phone for England and one phone for America and one phone for Australia, because I thought I was going to move to Australia, and I made a ton of friends there, and I kept going over, and I had a movie that I did there, Goddess, and I thought, well, that was going to be an open for me over there. And strangely, the reason I got Mary Poppins in New York is because it'd been on for a couple few years, and I thought, well, that ship sailed, they're never going to want me to come to Broadway. I don't know why. I did a movie, Sweeney Todd, and that got in the way of the first year time when they were doing it in America. So I thought, well, I'm never going to do that now. And then they, you know, I'd heard that they were doing Mary Poppins in Australia, and I was so excited at the idea of getting to do it there, because I really loved Australia and I love my friends there. And Cameron McIntosh said, no, we don't want someone there, we're going to pick an Australian girl, but we need someone from New York. And so within 6 weeks I was on a plane in New York doing Mary Poppins in New York again, and I was like, oh, I don't want to do it here, it's too much judging. What if I'm not as good as the first time I did it in London? You know, I had all these thoughts going through my head. What if I ruin the best, you know, I did so well in that, like people said nice things about me doing that, what if they say bad things about my new go at it? Anyway, not all of that was irrelevant. I'm just really glad that I bit the bullet and did it in New York, and it changed the course of my life, and one of the best decisions I ever made to do it again. Funnily enough, I'm doing it again in July in St. Louis for 3 weeks. All going well. I've been given the opportunity to go back to the Muni, which I love, because you get to do it with all these amazing kids that are up and coming and adults who are making their way into the business. And you get to do all generations. And within 3 weeks, you've got to show up and running. And that's brilliant fun. And so I get to do it again in St. Louis.
That's
July.
Amazing. I was going to ask, what was it like starting the role in the West End and then moving to New York? What were the differences between the two, besides, you know, countries?
Age. I was older, but wiser. Much more wise with my time. I don't think I fully, I underestimated the power of nutrition when I was 24. And the pressure, as blasé as I was, if you look at interviews of me doing interviews for Mary Poppins at 24 years of age, if there is any out there, I'm very blasé about it all. Like, oh yeah, this is fine. Like, I didn't truly realize the weight of it all until we got out of Bristol and we had opened the show in Bristol. And I was caught up in the fun of it all, so I didn't really concentrate on the pressure until we got to London. And then suddenly I got, there was a lot more pressure, and I was still pretending that it was easy, and it wasn't. It was a lot for a 24-year-old. And then doing it on Broadway again, I think the pressure of worrying about criticism at the beginning captured me a bit. And I think I was older, but for the show I was a lot wiser. I didn't drink alcohol and I didn't go out as much, and I ate really healthy and I worked out once a week, and I really took care of my body, and I really enjoyed it so much more than the first time. So yeah, I'm really glad that I revisited it 5 years later, because I was so much, I was older, but I was so much wiser. And I actually felt like they also lessened, there was like, I remember when it got to anything can happen if you let it, the first time around I would almost be in tears that, oh my gosh, I've got to do another 25 minutes and I'm absolutely spent. I remember being at the top of the stairs, especially on a 4-show weekend, and trying to hold back the tears that I've got another 25 minutes and I'm really exhausted. That I remember that vividly from when we first did it. It was just that little bit too long.
Yeah.
I didn't get any breaks, like, and they cut some things down to make it a lot easier in a way for this, for Broadway. Wisely too, instead of being in temper, which was a nursery scene after or before anything had happened, if you let it, that they, instead of being in it, I could go and have a toilet break. They took me out of it.
You put that, you know, throw a little break in there for,
it was a little bit, because I wasn't in that scene, it meant I could breathe and recover a bit now. And also I think they decided that it was going to be too scary to have Mary Poppins in that scene with them. It was better to remove her and her not quite acknowledge she knew what happened in that scene. I was so grateful. But by the time I went to Broadway, that I was able to have a break, toilet break.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, so yeah, to revisit it all the time, you know, there's parts that you can visit. It's that one I would like to revisit. What's that? The play, Speed the Plow. Mm-hmm. I would really like to revisit that one, David Mamet play, because that was really challenging too. It was a part too big for me. You know, you look back now and you think, I could have done better in that if I know what I know now. And I would probably revisit that too. And also I would revisit Galadriel, Queen of the Elves in Lord of the Rings, which I believe has not yet had its time. That show needs to come back. I mean, they never did it in America. They did it in Canada. And then they did it in the West End. And it had a short life there because it was way ahead of its time.
Mm-hmm.
Since that show, everybody's doing the immersive thing, you know, where the orcs and the hobbits would come into the crowd, and even as the audience came in, it was like they were in hobbit land and then saw this tree. And they're doing more and more of that now with, you know, the circus skills. I remember being in training for that for like 11 weeks, silk training, and then the end, all I do is come down looking like this on a tree.
Well, it's fun because I think now there are many shows on Broadway that do that. Moulin Rouge is the one that comes to mind because you walk in and they're in cage. They're all performing in their cages.
I never got to see it. Is that coming back? Did that close before COVID?
No, I don't think so. They should be coming back. I think they're coming.
Hope that comes back. I wanted to see that.
I saw it on a fluke. My friend or a group that I knew. They were in New York City doing whatever they were doing. And they were like, hey, we have an extra ticket. Would you like it? And that night I was like, cool, guess I'm seeing Moulin Rouge. You walk
in. Yeah, there's a reason that needs to open again. Yeah, I need to see that.
Yeah.
They all do. I just wish you could just suddenly click a finger and everything's back where it was before. But unfortunately, that's not going to happen. It's very sad for those shows that close too early.
They
all close too early, to be honest. People work really, really hard. If they don't last longer than a year, then that's sad. But things are going to look very different when we go back to it.
Yes, I was really sad because Frozen had just gotten like a little miniature upgrade with Sierra and Kenzie joining, and they changed a few songs around, so it was kind of like a whole new production going on. And Mean Girls had like a new cast coming out. I think they literally had like two or three performances with this new cast, and then COVID hit, and Mean Girls is closed. It's not returning. I think there are still a few tours returning once everything comes back. And
I enjoyed tour life to a certain degree. I think by 6 months in, I actually ended up doing it for 18 months, the King and I tour.
Yeah.
I stayed because I loved everybody so much. I fell in love with everybody's presence every day, and I felt super heartbroken to leave. But I really, after 6 months, my body was spent. So I did the King and I, and we had a fantastic rehearsal period in New York and then in Providence where we started. You really underestimate how hard that role is until you do a Monday travel day and set up again on Tuesday. You don't get a day off, none of them.
No.
And they used to say, you know, you get a golden day. You didn't really get a golden day to recover, really. You get 8 shows a week of that show, probably. And Yul Brynner didn't do it. There's a reason. Oh, yeah. I was a bit mentally drained by the end of those 18 months, but that said, best decision of my life, going on tour and experiencing that I would do it again in a heartbeat, probably just for 6 months and make sure I stick to my plan. As much as I love everybody on the tour, I would leave after 6 months because it's just a lot, you know, to not have those days off. There's just travel days, you know, and that within itself was a lot of fun. I didn't get to see any of the states we were in or the cities we were in because it was so hard work. I'd have to like recover all day every day, so I would probably do an easier show if that's a possibility, and I would give myself a 6 month limit.
Well, the thing is, because you travel on Mondays and then you have your 8 shows, and not only that, you're going from climates that are all
differing climates, and you underestimate that when you, and even altitudes. You underestimate the effect that that has on your body, and there's still that huge pressure. Don't go off, otherwise you're half of the actress you should be. That pressure's like there, and that, I mean, it's wrong to, you know, get caught up in that really, because you're not a robot. But it's very easy to like feel that weight. I mustn't let anyone down, we're only here for a week. If these people miss the show, then I mean, so I think tour life is not easy.
It's not for everyone either.
Not for the faint-hearted. And it took me a while to get adjusted to it as well. You have to learn how to manage that. But I'm glad I experienced it. And also, it's the reason I met my husband. When we were 6 days in Seattle, I met him day one, and we've been inseparable since. So thank God for that.
We love, you know, when shows bring people together. My roommate.
I also said to him, I'm never moving to Seattle. It rains here all the time. And here I am.
There you are.
We had a compromise. I keep my place in Louisiana and we go there to see my family all the time, and then we work here. It's working for me so far, especially as I got a show here right before my baby was born, the first one, Jane Austen. They let me do it really pregnant. Yeah. It's so progressive. They let me do Jane Austen heavily pregnant. I mean, none of us saw that the baby was going to come early, and I missed the last week of performances because baby decided to come early. That's okay. I was supposed to have him in Louisiana where my family was, and we ended up having him in Seattle. That's all fine. Glad that happened to you. I was really impressed with them, with Fifth Avenue Theatre. They make incredible work. They do incredible shows. They're really good at developing shows. Mm-hmm. So to do more work, there would be my hope that they'll have me back. And, I hope to do it when I'm not pregnant. It just gave that added element that was... it's a little bit harder.
I also want to chat a little bit about Finding Neverland, because you started before they were on Broadway with that.
We did like 5 workshops, and I don't even know how they kept me. We did one with Brian Darcy James. That was awesome. We did one with Jeremy Jordan and Matthew Morrison. Mm-hmm. Jeremy Jordan did it in Bristol. Wait, not Bristol. That was Mary Poppins. Cambridge, Massachusetts.
Cambridge, same thing.
They look similar. So we did Cambridge. That was really fun. The whole creation process for that was fun. The point was, to me, I learned a lot from that whole experience from beginning to end, because every version we did of the show, everyone would be in tears at the end, devastated in tears, because with the growth and the happiness and the joy and the grief at the end with the ending. I don't want to spoil it for somebody who hasn't seen it, but that moment that you'd worked all this way up to always had a payoff, no matter how we told the story. No matter how we told the story, there was always this beautiful lightness of spirit at the end, and release and relief. And that always astounded me. You could even change the writers of the show, which they did. You had the first version we did with Brian Darcy James, we had half of the story was written by different writers. And then the other half was written by Gary Barlow and Elliot Kennedy, who I had always wanted to work with. But so anyway, they went on to write the entire show, like from scratch, and the same response at the end, just everyone so moved. I think that's the story for you. I think that's the main gist of the story, is that, you know, this family inspires this magical place. And then in the end, this magical place is where one of the members goes to, mm-hmm. and in real life. And that in itself is so simple, isn't it? But yeah. There's so many ways to tell the story. And we did. But I did find, before it got to Broadway, that more and more of my lines were getting cut. I had to try my best to get some emotional depth to each tiny line I had left. And that was really hard. And then I know when they went on tour, and I'd always said, oh, can we add this? Can we add this, please? I'm really struggling with this, what I have left, to try and make it count. And I even watched back some of the videos. I'm like, I remember how that felt. But then I know that they put a ton of them back, my ideas, into the tour of it. It was obviously their idea too. But that it developed even after Broadway life, that it kept growing. And I know if it ever happened again, and I luckily get to play the mother again, I would benefit from having more lines to tell more of her story, which would be great. And but that's the trouble with the developing a story, is that you have to advocate for your character. And sometimes people don't want you to advocate. They're just like, say the line, shut up. You gotta try and make it count.
Yeah.
And as I get older, that's happening more and more. I don't know if it's because, you know, I'm growing into a different age bracket. Yeah. I don't know.
Well, I'm sure it would be interesting to go back now that you do have kids. So, you know, being a mother is now something totally different, I would think, than...
Oh my gosh. It doesn't... I do wonder, like, when I was playing a mother, how... I mean, you can't possibly know everything, every part you're ever going to play. Like, that's the point, is you get to experience things you've never experienced before on stage. And you try your best to look like you know what you're doing. But with this one, I think I definitely had no idea what being a mother really was.
Yeah.
I know now, but I don't know if my part would change any. Mm-hmm. I think, you definitely underestimate the sleepless nights and the weight of your care for a human being until it happened. I didn't know that. Mm-hmm. I could play being a mother, but I didn't know to what extent you would die for your children. You could you can play that, but you can't truly know it until you have them. Yeah, he's banging on the door. Raphael's like, mommy. Right on cue.
You know, well, thank you so much for sitting down with me and chatting.
You're welcome.
So much fun. I'm gonna put all of your social media and stuff down in the little box below for people to follow you.
Thanks.
And I wish you the best when it with the Muni and getting to revisit Mary Poppins again.
Oh my gosh, I'm so excited, and I hope it doesn't get moved for any reason. I think out of anywhere in the whole of the States, the Muni is the place to start, because it's 11,000 seated theater. You've got everybody can be as socially distanced as they want to. They're very serious about protecting people, and the space on stage, everyone, if needs be, everyone can have 10 feet apart from everybody,
right.
And there's gonna be a ton of children in it, so obviously, you know, safety is there first and foremost, but the idea that I get to play this part again, and I get to do it in the place that I find most fun, kind of, the Muni is a place that woke me up to my passion for theater again when I'd got a bit, you know, lazy. I'd gotten a bit lazy and a little bit like jaded. And I went to this place, the Muni, and to me it's magical because it's a place with fun, and you get to experience the other generation and you help them. And the idea that I get to play my favorite part with a bunch of like hundreds of kids, hundreds, because there's a step in time, you know, there's a ton of places for kids can be a part of.
Yeah.
Get to relive this incredible part again. I'm pumped. I'm really pumped. So hopefully people can get their tickets already for that, and I'm assuming it's going to go ahead. I'm just hopeful, you know. Yeah,
fingers crossed.
Good. Come and see us do that in July.
Yes, we'll share once all that information comes out. We'll share it out here.
Well, lovely meeting you, lovely talking to you. Yes, and hopefully again soon.
Yes, totally.
Bye.